Okay, so welcome to this session about interactive Python programming. My name is David Vujic, and I live and work in Stockholm, Sweden. So I'm a developer, and today I focus mainly on Python software development. So I do this at work, and I also do this on my spare time in my open source projects. And before that, I've been part of the Lisp community. I've been a Clojure developer, and also like way back, I was in the Microsoft world and developed C# and .NET stuff. So what I've been doing lately is to try to improve the developer experience when you write Python code. So what I'm going to, what I want to talk about is this, but also I want to begin with feedback loops, because I think it's very related to this interactive programming style, like having this nice feedback when you write code. So I'm going to begin with that. So this image, you know, this circle is supposed to be a visualization of a feedback loop. So let's say we write our code, and then we deploy it to production. So, and then when it's running there, we can check if things work or if maybe someone else will let us know. So maybe our customers will let us know. So that's a pretty slow feedback loop with potential risks of like damaging your business and or whatever. So this is obvious, of course. So a faster feedback loop probably is to have these this some kind of automation when you do commits, or maybe you have this pull request things and even review. So maybe not always as fast as deploy, but don't deploy directly to production, but it's probably safer, and often you get this automated feedback faster anyway. But it's still kind of slow, you know, you have to wait, you have to push things to GitHub maybe or and wait. So there's faster ways for sure to get feedback. So a much faster way is to write code and write some unit tests and run those unit tests. So then you do everything on your local machine, and you will get fairly quickly learn if your code does what you think it does, or if it doesn't. So I want to zoom in to this test write code and test flow a bit. So let's do that. So in as a developer, I have used a thing called test driven development for quite some time, and I find that this way workflow or way of working is very fast when it comes to getting feedback on what your code does and how you should continue the development. So test-driven development is basically that you start writing a test for something that you want to develop, and then you continue developing that, and then you go back to the test and modify the code, and you go back and forth between the test and the code, tests and the code. So it's sort of like a ping-pong game. So and I find this very very effective when you want to get feedback and to know how to continue the development. So the most important thing that I feel is that you know what the code does. You learn very quickly. So let's zoom into this TDD flow a little bit. So the last couple of years, I've been doing a slightly different thing, which is called REPL-driven development. And REPL-driven development is very similar to test-driven development, but I find it even quicker. You get feedback even quicker than with a regular TDD setup. So REPL-driven development is about writing and evaluating code in a REPL, basically. And you can do experiments, and you can refactor and reevaluate, and you get instant feedback on what the code does and what you need to change. So I think that's even faster than test-driven development. So, okay, REPL-driven development. So let's go back. So what's the REPL? So most of you, most of developers know what a REPL is. So the most common setup is having this, you open this shell and you use the REPL for your programming language. In this case, I'm using the Python REPL or the IPython REPL, which is an enhanced REPL for Python development. So what happens here is that we start a REPL session in isolation. So this session knows about the Python environment. So it knows about the Python language, basically. So as soon as we start writing things, so adding variables or creating, writing functions or even doing imports, so then this session will be more and more aware of the code. So we will add things to the session, and then that means that we can run functions, we can print out these variables and things like that. But with REPL-driven development, it's not really that. Well, at least not what I mean with REPL-driven development. So what I'm thinking of is that you are in your code editor where you have like your autocomplete and you have your syntax highlighting and your favorite theme, color theme, and all of those things. But instead you have this running REPL in the background or in a smaller shell, smaller window or buffer. So that means that you write code and you can send that code to the running REPL, to the REPL session. So you write and do everything as you would do when writing your code, basically. So in this case, in this example, I have evaluated these two functions. I've sent them to the REPL session, so it's aware of these functions. And then I switched to a separate, different module and evaluated that one. So the REPL session now knows about these two functions and also these two variables. And that means that I can evaluate the state of those variables and change code and reevaluate and things like that. So in this example, if you look in the smaller area there, you see that I have evaluated this res variable on line 6, and the output was that it's a dictionary with two keys and two values, basically. So this setup is it works in basically all of any of your favorite code editors. So you can do this in Visual Studio Code, you can do this in PyCharm or Vim. But what I have done is that, or more like what I have missed is that when I write code and do this evaluation, this is really cool, but then I need to switch context if I want to see the result. I have to switch context to this other window. I have to look. I have my focus on the code, and then I have to look in another different place to know the results. And if it's a larger output, then maybe I need to scroll. So I wanted to find out if it was possible to make this even smoother and faster. This feedback loop even faster. So I don't have to switch context. What I've done here is that I can select a row or a region, and I can evaluate, and then an overlay, a small pop-up shows up with the result, evaluated result right next to it. So I can change code and reevaluate and quickly see the result of it without doing this context switching. So the way I've done it is that I wanted to reuse the existing tools, the tooling that I already had. So I know that this, my in editor REPL, the IPython REPL, already does this evaluation. So I figured maybe I can extract the data and do this visualization as a separate thing. So that's how I've done it. What I've done is that I've created this overlay and placed it where my cursor currently is, right next to the code, and then I've extracted the evaluated result and put it in this overlay, And I also want this overlay to have this nice looking syntax. So I've set it to this Python mode, so we get this syntax highlighting and make it look very readable. And as a developer experience, nice developer experience thing, I also when you move the cursor, of course you don't want the overlay to be there. You want it to disappear. So that's those kinds of things I've added. So putting the overlay at the right place and feed it with the evaluated data, and then make it disappear when it's not interesting to look at anymore. So what I've described so far is something that I use on a daily basis, and it covers most of my needs while doing Python development. But one thing I still miss, and I miss it from my days as a Clojure developer, because over there we could have a running app on our local machine, and we can have our editor, and the app and the editor were connected. So when I did some changes in the code, the app would change without any restarts or anything like that. And the same if I would change the state of the app, I can inspect the state from the code. So they were connected. They are connected. So I was thinking, hey, this would be really cool if we could have it something like this in Python. So and that reminded me of Jupyter and Jupyter Notebooks, because I think notebooks, the way you do things there is very similar to what I was trying to achieve. So I was reading up a little bit on how this notebook thing works, and it turns out that a notebook is a client that talks to a server, that communicates with a server, and it's on the server that all this Python evaluation and all this thing happens. And then what I've done is that instead of starting up IPython in my editor, I start the Jupyter console instead, and then I can give it that unique ID, and it will be connected to that running kernel. So in this example, I've created this fast API CRUD app that has this create, read, and update and delete endpoints. And it has this, it's locally running, it has this database where you can do all these things. So I'm running this Fast API app in the kernel, and then I've connected to the kernel. I've connected to the kernel in my editor too. So both of them are connected to the kernel. So what I do now is that I want to initially create some data. So I'm going to add creating this message, and what I get back is a message ID. So I want to experiment in my browser. What do I get with that message ID? So I'm evaluating the read function, and I instantly get this evaluated result, which was this hello world text. So what happens if I do some changes in this app? So I'm going to grab this message ID and write something else. So now I can evaluate the same thing again, and you can see that the content has changed to this new value. So my editor isn't in any debug mode or something like that, or it doesn't know what database, and it doesn't have any environment variable set up or something like that. It is only connected to the kernel, and the kernel is aware of that. It's running the app, it has the connection strings and everything that is needed. So that's how this thing works. So now I want to do some inline hacking, because I want to store this input that is sent from this app, because I want to work with it afterwards. So I can add this dictionary that stores this message. So I'm updating this the source code of this app, and when I run any of these endpoints again, you will see that that this I've grabbed the ID of this this message. So the state changes and the new inputs are I can grab and I can use them for quick evaluation or testing. So this example is really simple. It was just an integer, but you can imagine that sending like a more complex object, maybe a pedantic schema or something, and then you want to inspect what's coming in, and if you have some sort of validation that you want to test out. So the configuration or the code that I wrote to make this work is a little bit different than adding an overlay. So I'm using this overlay just like with the IPython example, but in this case, when I change code, I have to think about where that code lives, because it's the app that runs the code. And so it's in the app context I need to manipulate with the data. So if you started the app from some, maybe a main function, and that module imports namespaces, then you need to, if you want to update a function or something like that, you need to update it in the correct namespace. So what I did before in IPython, by adding and changing things, everything ends up in the global namespace. But here, if you want the app to actually react to the changes, you need to put it in the right namespace. So that's what I do here. So I do some lookups, where is this function, and then I do this reload of this function or module. And when I was developing this, I was thinking, hey, this is really ugly. I'm in this REPL and do some manipulation of the imports and things like that. So, and that didn't feel good. And then I was reminded of IPython, and IPython has this feature to reload any updated submodules. I was curious, how do they do it? So I looked in the IPython source code and saw that they also use importlib and reloading of this module. So once I've learned that, then I stopped thinking that my code was hacky. I thought it was good enough at least. So yeah. But one thing that has bothered me since for a long time is I quite often want to test out and evaluate individual rows that lives in a function, and quite often this code uses the input to that function, like the input parameters. So to be able to do that, I need to manually like type some fake data and set it to this variable, and then I can evaluate the code. But I think that takes that slows me down. So I was thinking maybe I can do this in a quicker way, so I have this quicker feedback, so I can run this or evaluate this code much quicker. So my idea was maybe I can use an LLM for this. So if I give it the parameters, maybe it can return some random data, so I don't have to write it myself. So I ended up doing that. So I have this source code. I'm starting up, loading the repo with the code. And then I select this function name and the parameters with its data type. So I have this prompt that instructs the LLM to come up with fake data based on the tag name and on the data type. And then I can send that to the repo. So I do that with a key command. And then I can proceed by running the code within the function that uses this inputs. So this works for all the data types. If there's a custom data type, you need to give the LLM extra context. So that's a thing to think about. But once it knows the context, it can generate this fake data that very often is good enough just to test out, you know, like I've done here, like list destructuring and parsing and things like that. And I think that was all I had, and thank you for listening.